So thank you very much to Aisha for presenting the first part of this evening by concentrating on Istanbul. And with Bediz Yilmaz, we have a talk about the city of Mersin. I'd like to just briefly introduce her. Bediz Yilmaz did her bachelor in public administration at Marmara University in Istanbul and continued on to do her MA in sociology at Boğaziçi University. Before completion of her degree, she received a scholarship from the Council of Higher Education, Yüksek Öğretim Kurulu, to do her master's and PhD in urbanism and urbanization in France. And the irony is that the institution that they awarded her with that fellowship is the same institution that dismissed you from your position just a few years later. Bediz Yilmaz returned to Turkey in 2006 and joined the Public Administration Department of Mersin University. From 2007 until 2016, Bediz worked at Mersin University as an assistant professor. She lectured on a variety of subjects, particularly on urban sociology, local governments, urban and social politics. In August 2016, having signed the petition Academics for Peace, like many of the lecturers in this Ringvorlesung, if not all, I think, she was dismissed from Mersin University by that very same institution, YÖK. In February 2017, Bediz became a Philip Schwarz Fellow here in Germany and joined the Institute for Migration Research and Intercultural Studies at the University of Osnabrück. Yilmaz's research interests revolve around urban segregation, the rural-urban continuum, forced migration, so you see the overlaps between her and Ayşe Çavdar's work, and social policy, as well as the intersection of all of these with the notion of gender. Please help me welcome Bediz. Yes, and the title of her talk is Three Moments of a Struggle Against Urban Renewal in Mersin, Intervention, Resistance, Imagination.
Well, thank you very much, Kader. I'm very happy to be part of this seminar session. And I really thank Rauf and Kader to have invited me and to share the desk with Ayşe also. And welcome. I think that my speech will complete and complement that of Ayşe. I will be speaking of a specific case, which is in Mersin. Mersin is a southern city at the Mediterranean coast of Turkey, easter than Antalya and western than Antakya, so in the middle. And I will try to speak of the three moments of a struggle against the urban renovation, urban transformation in Mersin, which are intervention, resistance, and imagination, as you see here. Yes. What I will try to focus on is the is to talk about a case where the omnipotency of TOKİ is the mass housing agency, which is responsible for the main part of urban transformation projects in Turkey, other than the private ones. I mean, Ağoğlu is a private contractor, but TOKİ is a state one doing practically the same thing. But the bulk of transformation projects is realized by TOKİ. And it is really like that emerged, especially after 2003, as an institution, an unquestionable institution with a great power to destroy and reconstruct and change the urban policies, change the land policies, property policies even, and influencing the landscape and property scape of the cities in Turkey. So the case that I will talk about is little resistance story, like that of the Gaulois village of Asterix, which could stand up against that big power of the Roman Empire. But at the end, it doesn't finish as such. It is a bad ending, after all, but for a while, we believed in it. I will not make this long, but do you see the cursor? No, okay. Okay, so this is Mersin as a whole. It is a very long city, which is all along the Mediterranean coast, because very near the sea, the mountains are starting. So in many parts of the sea, you have a band of land in which the settlements could be done. So I hope that you can read the historical center and the first working class neighborhoods, etc. I will not talk about this in detail, but can you read that newly formed neighborhoods after the massive migration of Kurds during the 90s? So this is the phase about which Ayşe also talked, about the village evictions, forced migration, and internally displaced people in Turkey. Mersin is one of the cities in the western part of Turkey which received a massive migration of this forced migration, and the eastern part of the city is where they settled mainly, forming a nearly, I don't know, around 20 neighborhoods, very densely settled in 10, 20 years, we might say. So this part of the city is also where the industries or, I mean, the working class is living there, or the workers in the informal sector also lives there. So this is the working class part. And when you move towards the west in the city, it is also the class is also, you move in the class line also, class ladder. That means that around the center, a bit west of the center, you have the middle class, and towards the west and towards the mountains, you have middle upper classes. So the urban transformation project took place in these Kurdish neighborhoods formed after the 90s. So this is just to show how densely settled is this neighborhood. Mainly the left part of the picture of the map, you will see that it is quite densely settled, and the right hand side is more agricultural zone, we might say. And yes. So why are these neighborhoods chosen? In fact, this is why it also received a major reaction, also is explained by the answer of this question. This is that mass housing agency, the urban transformation, was entered Mersin quite late than other cities. And the urban transformation project proposed by TOKİ was introduced in 2008. And they said that we finally came. You called us, you invited us, and we came. That kind of slogans were launched. And they were also saying that Mersin would finally have a modern look. Mersin would finally have modern housing. And that the city will finally save from its primitive and bad-looking and ugly housings. I mean, and it was quite welcomed by a good portion of the city also, which had a negative opinion about the forced migration of Kurds in Mersin. But among the Kurds and among the democratic public opinion, I mean, in Mersin they call themselves as democratic, but I don't know how this term fits. How can we say more? They're more open. I mean, they are more leftist, and they I don't know. Maybe the term democratic fits, liberal. Yeah, yeah. Okay, but they were quite open to the cosmopolitanism of Mersin, and they were defending human rights, and they were defending labor rights also. They were quite welcoming to the Kurds, etc. That they were they really immediately were aware of the signification of this project, which means that it, even in the central zones of, in the historical center of Mersin, you would have some about to collapse city, buildings or houses, and if an urban transformation was needed, it should have been there. It didn't start there, but it started in the Kurdish, in three of the Kurdish neighborhoods. And people started thinking, and they were quite right, and then started to look for another purpose behind this, thinking that this was a project to disperse this density of the Kurdish settlements, that this had a political significance, that as it happened in Tarlabaşı and as it happened in Sulukule, it was a project of cleaning in the physical sense and in the social sense of the word. So they were cleaning what? Cleaning the unwanted and cleaning the dangerous. Because the density of the Kurdish settlements allowed allowed these people to have a certain power, especially in the political sense, in the political area. Because Mersin is quite particular in the Turkish political landscape, that means that maybe you can read the party signs. It is the only city where the Nationalist Party has a district, a municipality, just neighboring the Kurdish, pro-Kurdish party, just neighboring the center social democratic party, CHP, and overall, in the time of the urban transformation project, governed by a metropolitan municipality of CHP. And I mean, this has been possible. The Kurdish party, or pro-Kurdish party, could have won a municipality thanks to this density of settlement. And if this was to be dispersed, if this was to be dissolved by an urban transformation project of that scale, then the political outcome, the electoral outcome would also change. And this was among the targets, the aims of the project. A reaction was established immediately. But I mean, in this talk, I want to put the accent not on the reaction among the city in general, but how the municipality itself could lead an opposition to the project that ended in a victory, at least until now. Because I think it is quite particular that it needs mentioning its specific moments. So here you see the initial project, and let me say, as I said, it began in 2008. But from 2008 until 2012, we really didn't know what was it about. I mean, we Mersin public opinion was, I mean, we were hearing there will be an urban transformation project, they will come, they will do this, they will do that, but there was never a certain project proposed. But in 2012, then the project appeared. And it was briefly comprising of constructing buildings of 12 stories to a vacant land, and then moving the people to these buildings, and then destructing their houses, and then building high-story buildings there, plus, as it is the industrial zone, as I said, and the hinterland of the logistics sector, also building some warehouses and other things, and moving people back to there. And initially, at 2008, it was not the Kurdish party at the government, at the administration of the municipality, and they signed the protocol with Turkey, and they were really eager to start the project because it promised the modernization of the housing in that part of the city. But then after the elections, when the DTP then came into power, and when the details of the project were pronounced, the municipality itself became a fervent opponent to the project. And they did a number of things within their struggle. I want to briefly mention them. These are, as you see, seeking expert advices and making field analysis, questionnaires, and various meetings with experts and professional chambers and others, and academics and other figures of prominent figures of Mersin, which consists of preparing establishing a team of municipal workers, of urban planners and sociologists and other workers to get a real picture of what is going on, and getting a real picture of what people inhabiting this area wanted and needed. And and when they discovered that people were willing to have their neighborhoods transformed, then it was said that people would not want this to be done by Toki, but by the municipality itself. So they were asking the municipality to be open to the demands of the inhabitants, but doing this by themselves. Judiciary means have been effectively used. That means that the municipality itself opened court cases against what Toki was using for its purposes. For example, Turkey needed to declare some lands as expropriated to build new houses there. But when the municipality opened a court case against this, this channel was blocked. So it consisted of blocking the strategy of Turkey and the governorship of Mersin, of course, in every means, in every step. And that made Turkey change its project. And this, I don't know, but maybe if you know another example of it, I mean, Turkey had to alter its initial project to fit, to hush the reactions and to fit the demands of the people there. And what they did is quite striking, in my opinion, because imagine that these are Kurdish neighborhoods and with two, three story houses, individual houses with gardens. And in the gardens or on the street, they have tandırs. Tandır is what they use to make the bread. So in the new project of Turkey, you see the women preparing. And the buildings were half of the that proposed at the initial project. Now these are six story, and they also put the grape, you see, on the top, because in I don't know if it's you can see. Imagine that in the Gecekon neighborhoods, you have on top of each house a grape, and under it, people come together and eat their meals, everything. And here also, they put the grape trees on top of the houses, saying that we respect your kind of living, we respect that you need to make your tandır, and we respect that you need that green in your houses, and we do as you wish. And at the same time, they changed the emplacement of that buildings where they would transfer the people and build in their neighborhoods while they are living in the other place. Do you remember? This is called the reserve residences. They move the people there, they build in there, and then they bring back, but they can never go back, in fact, because the newly built ones are not affordable by the people. But in any case, this is the initial plan. So they changed the place where they would do that, because in the first place, let me say that, in Mersin, it is very difficult to find a big public land or even a big vacant land because of the property structure in that city. And when the vacant land that Turkey found mainly belonged to the municipality of Akdeniz, and it was okay when it was CHP, but when it changed, when the party, the governing party changed, and when the municipality did not allow this, then they tried to find another vacant land, and this was the Ataş workers' residences. Ataş is a refinery which functioned in Mersin for many years. Now it is, is it functioning or is it empty now? It is only like a reservoir of oil now, but it functioned for many years. And this is the part of the workers' residences. Built during the 50s, it is a very interesting plot of land, a very different landscape within that part of Mersin. I will show you this. Okay, it's not very easy to recognize from there. It is a private land, of course. It belonged to that company. But thanks to the legal arrangements Ayşe talked about, they could proceed to an expropriation of this land belonging to the private company and destroy the houses existing there, which were empty in any case, destroy them and reconstruct their buildings there. But what the municipality did is also quite interesting, because these houses are very nice houses, the whole environment is very nice, etc. And they made an application to the Patrimonial Protection Council, and they managed to obtain the label of urban architectural heritage site for this area. While they were they obtained this label, Toki entered the place and started to destroy the buildings. And then it was a public demonstration, and they could stop it, isn't it? Alec Bey is also from Mersin. Maybe he would complete what I forget. So thanks to this label, the municipality could stop the implementation of this project. But of course, it didn't stop there. Toki, which obtained the ownership of this place, meanwhile, by the expropriations, etc., made an appeal of this decision. And the whole affair is still continuing, but at the meantime, the project was stopped, could have been stopped, thanks to the municipality's efforts. And the municipality could also, this is the third part of the talk, could propose an alternative urban transformation project, or an alternative project to the inhabitants of these neighborhoods, using the same area but in another way, proposed by Toki, which consists of using the this area, like in the example of Sümer Park in Diyarbakır, with some social functioning buildings, some educational or vocational spaces, also residences, and making, if you see the housing pattern, which is surrounding the area, you will see that social and green public space is really lacking there, because it is very densely settled, and it is also surrounded by a high wall. It was separated from the neighborhoods. And what the municipality proposed was to tear down this wall and open this space to public use by proposing some activities and education, etc., and bringing a fresh air to this part of the city, which was quite revolutionary for this land. And they also proposed an alternative transformation. I mean, it is not very nice, but still it is, of course, better than tearing this house down and building a 12-story building instead of it, to renovate and to bring about better infrastructural means. So you will see the difference of the urban tissues within the wall and outside the wall. And an urban researcher, Cihan Baysal, saw in that this effort of the municipality to create, to realize a dream, making the urban an alternative urban living true. But these are my two last slides. In December 2016, a new era began, and the Akdeniz municipality, a trustee was appointed, and the mayors, the co-mayors, have been arrested. A major part of the municipal councillors are arrested, and the workers are dismissed. I mean, those who are from the HDP are dismissed. And the trustee is the district governor. So the appointed one took the place of the elected administrator. And immediately after that, in April 2017, there's a new protocol which is signed, which comprises another portion of the district. But he said that we believe that this will be a very good urban transformation project, and this will continue with the three neighborhoods which were before included in the urban transformation of Mersin. So in a very recent, near future, we will also see the transformation project which was prevented, the implementation of which was prevented by the municipality to be implemented. Yes, thank you for having listened.